In the small community of Elsa, at the end of what used to be the city's industrial corridor, the land lays quietly, almost unassuming amongst the neighborhoods that surround it, like the rest of the property lining the railroad tracks that once ran through here. It is run down and sullen, an inconspicuous eyesore that has been ignored for more than a generation now. People walk past it, children ride their bikes through here, even play here, despite the large rusty container that reads danger, sulfuric acid. But those who are old enough to remember still speak of this place, usually in hushed and grave tones. Today, the story of Red Barn, at what many fear may have been left behind, continues to haunt those who still smell the effects today. Unlike all the other industrial plants that were developed in the middle of town, the Red Barn Chemical Company was often regarded with suspicion, caution, and fear. Interestingly enough, though many local residents have their own stories about the Red Barn, there are very few who can provide any factual details about the company. All we've been able to discover so far is a murky picture of this place, clouded by documents that lead to dead ends, neighbors who were afraid to speak, and physical clues that only provide small insights into what lies below the surface. The story we have been able to piece together begins in July 1963, when the Red Barn Chemical Company purchased the property in Elsa from MF and Beatrice McKee for the sum of $6,500. The site was the base of operations for other branches throughout South Texas as far north as Corpus Christi, operating as a pesticide producer. Many still recall the actual Red Barn structure and the effects it created in their neighborhood.
I remember the Red Barn very clearly. Huge company. Trains always stopped there almost every day. Almost every day as they're dropping off chemicals, picking up chemicals. So this was like an everyday thing, of course.
We were the eighth house from the railroad. And we were south of the railroad. And most of the time here in South Texas, our winds are from the southeast or south. We were lucky we only got the smelly problems in the winter because we lived on the other side of the railroad.
Hang out there, play around there.
Oh yeah, we were kids. We'd elementary school, we'd go over to where the water plant's at right now, and we'd swim in the water plant and then leave and hang out next to the on the railroad tracks, and we'd go up and back on the where the railroad tracks used to be, cut across to the chemical plant itself.
I started working there back in about 1966, 67, somewhere around there, until 1971. And what I used to do with them is I was classified as a serviceman.
After the Red Barn Chemical Company was liquidated in May 1967 to Sunray DX Oil Company, many continued to refer to the site as Red Barn, even after ownership continued to change hands several times over the years. Several accounts from different people place the closing of the plant around the mid-1980s.
We're starting to close the Red Barn around that time frame, if I'm not mistaken. Late 80s. I would say late 80s is when they were getting everything out of there.
Nearly everyone remembers the plant closing abruptly, almost hastily, shutting down all operations from one day to the next.
Close the doors and, it was all of a sudden as well, as I remember. They were in operation, then a couple of days later, it was shut down.
The deserted buildings only stood for a few more years before they fell apart and were torn down. One building was burned to the ground, and though most of the physical evidence of the place had finally disappeared, the saga of Red Barn would not end there. The Red Barn Chemical Company was literally crammed into the middle of town, pushed up against the city's water treatment plant and people's backyards, as many residents can attest to.
And again, like I say, I used to jog from my house there close to Kennedy Elementary, west on my 9th Street, and then I'd hit mile 6 and go south, and I'd run past that site. And there were occasions when I would see a flatbed railroad car unloading. There'd be the railroad people, and the chemical company would have a backhoe, and they dug a hole next to the railroad tracks, and they were dumping the 55-gallon drums of chemicals or whatever it was in there, in that hole, and then they'd cover it.
People didn't have air conditioning most of the time back then, so they left their windows open. Guess what? We were breathing it in, and we weren't even aware of it.
And again, when it would rain, I mean, you could even see it gurgling, okay, and bubbling. Something was coming up to the surface because the 55-gallon drums were corroding.
Yes, they had those pipes coming up from the top. You know, when they were filling out these trains, pues all that dust is in the air. You know, whatever's coming in, going in those trains. You know, so yes, you could smell it. Of course, we were like kids, just running around playing. You know, never paid attention to it.
The effects of this industrial hot zone were felt daily by those who lived nearby, who could easily witness what many have called a negligent work environment.
Now, you can see the barrels are still there. Those barrels were filled to the maximum. And if they did not take care of them in time, they would overflow. Now, you see them filled with cactus and cacti and grass growing on them, and they're still there. They've done nothing about that.
Even those who worked there say they intuitively understood what was happening, even if they were unaware of this at the time.
No, I just do want to say that at that time, you know, this issue that may be coming up, it just never crossed our minds. I mean, we never discussed it, you know, what if this happens or what if that happens? It was never discussed even among my coworkers. Mm-hmm.
It was until years afterward when tragedy helped to raise eyebrows and questions for people. Story after story of family loss and personal afflictions began to be recognized as the possible symptoms of a community that was left to fend for itself against hazardous conditions.
My sister was first stages of cancer. My oldest sister caught it on time. I was at the first stages of cancer. I took care of it right away.
Let me ask you something. How many of you here have a relative that has cancer? I'm just curious, or has died from cancer?
The tears and struggles and diseases that people have endured, specifically in the neighborhood surrounding the Red Barn, were hard to ignore. Something here did not smell right. What ensued was anger.
These are issues that need to be tackled. These are issues that need to be addressed.
Anger from those who felt they have been wronged. Anger from those who wanted answers and were not receiving them. Was the Red Barn responsible for the death and the devastation of so many? Who were the men who said they had come to investigate? What were the papers our neighbors were signing? And what happened to the lawsuit that was filed against Red Barn?
I remember my mom telling me there were some neighbors that they came by and asked for signatures. I couldn't tell you about it because I at that time I wouldn't know, but they did come in and ask for some signatures on I'm assuming questions or trying to get some information, you know.
But up to now, I don't know whatever happened to the lawsuit. All of a sudden it just died out.
For many years now, the lack of resolution has only caused the painful memories of those who lived in the shadow of Red Barn to worsen. Many have talked about the hopes families had had any sort of resolution being lost in the thick smoke that was Red Barn. As the large tank that read Danger seemed to just blend into the background of the neighborhood, the stories and the history faded even more as the years passed. The story wouldn't resurface again until 2003, when a group of Edcow Chelsea High School students, under the guidance of Ernesto Ayala and the Llano Grande Center, rediscovered Red Barn and began collecting the oral histories of those who were willing to talk. The work of these students resulted in a digital story that chronicled these histories. Awareness began to be built as those students shared their work with the community. In 2008, armed with a sense of responsibility to their local and global environment and the shock of hearing the stories emerge from community members yet again, this year's class of Llano Grande students decided they would continue the work that had been begun with the original Red Barn video. Building on the oral tradition, they continued to listen to the stories of their elders, amazed at many of the deeply personal tragedies people suffered, and angered by the lack of injustice they perceived. It became clear that the effects of the Red Barn Chemical Company weren't just environmental or health-related. They were profound sentiments in people of racial injustice, corporate irresponsibility, and general fear in the community. The wound that had been created had never been healed, and the students began to understand the immensity of the work they were doing. With an unabashed willingness to dig deeper, the Llano Grande class visited the Red Barn chemical site and the surrounding neighborhoods, collecting data, evidence, and stories. Much of the physical evidence they found at the site was disturbing. Open pits, yellow dirt, children's toys. Survey data they collected was grim. Histories of cancer, miscarriage, and birth defects abounded in this community. But the cooperation they received from the people who lived there was encouraging. This time around, students found community members who were more aware of the history and more willing to talk, giving them the ammunition they needed to take action. With a better understanding of the fear people felt, the history of the space and the conditions that existed there, the students were ready to create an action plan for change.
But I think we should pay more attention to it, that it really is dangerous.
The first step of this process was to open the eyes of as many people as possible, beginning at the local level, but also going to state agencies for assistance.
We can go out there, that's not a problem. We work for the state of Texas. We are not a private company, so we work for the state of Texas, for citizens, for the community.
Their goals have been made clear. They want an investigation, and they want the site cleaned up. The land cannot lay quietly anymore. Beyond that, an excitement has been built around the potential of this space for healing. Recognizing the tragedy that has occurred here, students have learned that part of the process for rehabilitating the land includes creating a sense of resolution for the community here. Our youth have been inspired to envision what possibilities exist for using this land, and the ideas they've brought forth ring of respect for the community and the hope for the future.
The reason I did this is because I felt that having the Red Barn Chemical Company there is sort of in a way, kidding our community, making it ugly and making people get sick and stuff like that, so.
But they know the work is not at this point yet. At the corner of 4th and Hidalgo Street in Elsa, the land of the Red Barn Chemical Company still sits open and the wind still blows across the wasteland into the home of many.
What we're going to do, we're going to go and get some soil samples on that property, and so that we can determine how contaminated it is.
We look to the community for help and guidance. We look to your words for knowledge, and we look forward to the day when our home is safe again.